Macmillan Audio presents Saving Earth, Climate Change, and the Fight for Our Future. Written by Olugbemisola Rhuday-Perkovich. Read for you by Imani Jade Powers. Introduction. Nathaniel Rich. What follows is the story of our time. One of the most incredible things about it is that very few people know how it began, though you will soon, and nobody knows how it will end, though you, decades from now, might. The most surprising thing about it, however, is that you and I and everybody we know are its main characters. As you listen to this story, remember that you are also its hero. The story of climate change and our response to it is the story of modern civilization. Consider all the godlike powers we take for granted: refrigeration, indoor cooking, temperature control, modern medicine, motorcycles, cars, buses, helicopters, airplanes, spaceships, the internet, supermarkets and everything you find in them, laundry machines, dishwashers, light bulbs, garage doors, sneakers, books, plastic, TikTok. Nearly any technology that shapes our lives relies upon the consumption of massive quantities of energy. For nearly all of human history, most of that energy has come from burning fossils. Eons worth of dead things, dinosaurs, trilobites, plants, trees, moss, algae, decomposed, sunk into the earth, and were dug up and burned by enterprising human beings. Like something out of a zombie movie, however, the Earth's dead things are now seeking their revenge, overheating the planet and sowing chaos. Our greatest source of power has yielded the most vicious threat our civilization has faced. The story of climate change is also the story of human failure, of warnings ignored, of missed opportunities, and of malevolent actors, chief among them those who have profited from the extraction and manufacture of fossil fuels. As I write this introduction in 2022, we are only beginning to rid ourselves of the disinformation campaign that was codified at the highest levels of the oil and gas industry in the late 1980s, just as major global climate policy was being proposed and drafted by the United States and the world's other largest nations. The disinformation campaign persists, however, as does the political division it caused. We have been brought to this point by the nearsighted decisions of powerful people in positions of great responsibility. Anyone born in the 21st century will, at some point in their lives, come to realize that they have been dealt a bad hand. Those who are most responsible for getting us into this mess are the ones who will be least harmed by it. The most innocent, the youngest, will suffer the most. The perverse cruelty of climate change cuts along every social divide. It aggravates nearly every form of inequality in society. Those who face the sharpest discrimination, people of color, indigenous communities, the poor, the infirm, the undereducated, are most severely threatened. Those who want most badly to defeat the problem often have the least political power to do so. This grim history does not doom us to a grim future. A vast range of outcomes remains available, with an enormous gulf between best and worst-case scenarios. And more than 40 years after Rafe Pomerantz, James Hansen, and Al Gore first tried to force the United States government to act, a new generation has seized leadership of the fight, with sudden and dramatic consequences. In Saving Earth, Olugbemisola Rhuday-Perkovich explains how we got here, gives a vivid portrait of the critical moment in which we find ourselves, and introduces the young visionaries who have reshaped the public conversation in just a few years. The future, we know, will look nothing like the past. It will be warmer, yes, and the strains of climate change will harm us in ways both darkly predictable and unforeseen. But the struggle against the ravages of warming will also be led by a new cohort of activists, engineers, and thinkers. This new generation doesn't look like the previous ones, and it won't act like them either. Young people faced with the threat of climate change in the 2020s will not tolerate delays or make excuses. They won't be distracted by the old political tricks. They will understand that survival of the world as we know it will depend on a profound commitment to honesty, responsibility, and above all, justice. Saving Earth is their story, and yours. Part 1. Where We Are. Today, almost 9 out of 10 Americans do not know that scientists agree, well beyond the threshold of consensus, that human beings have altered the global climate through the indiscriminate burning of fossil fuels. Nathaniel Rich, Losing Earth, A Recent History. Chapter 1. Letting Old Habits Die, Hard. Vision, Voices, and Vegetables. In 2009, New York City students at the Brooklyn New School started a campaign that later became part of an effort called Styrofoam Out of Schools. Their mission? Well, you can probably guess it from the name. But to be clear, they wanted to get plastic foam lunch trays out of schools. The students weren't worried that the trays were too flimsy or ugly or made out of a weird substance that wasn't found in nature. They weren't trying to be different, even though the idea of using anything other than plastic foam trays in cafeterias was very different. They were concerned that the trays, which were used for only a few minutes before they were tossed in the trash, were not biodegradable and stayed around for hundreds, if not thousands, of years. Styrofoam is the trade name for polystyrene foam, a plastic material with many tiny air pockets trapped in its structure. Like many plastics, polystyrene is derived from petroleum. Petroleum, another word for oil, a liquid that is naturally present in certain layers of rock beneath the Earth's surface. It can be removed and refined to produce fuels including gasoline, kerosene, and diesel oil. Like coal, petroleum is a fossil fuel, meaning that it is formed over millions of years from the remains of plants and animals deep within the Earth's crust. Plastic foam is used in food containers, packaging, insulation, and more because it is lightweight, inexpensive to produce, and excellent at keeping hot things hot and cold things cold. But it's also, well, plastic and not biodegradable. That's just one of its problems. Not only is fossil fuel an ingredient, but the manufacturing process releases greenhouse gases that cause global warming, which can be said of the manufacturing process of just about any product, and it involves toxic chemicals linked to cancer. When the foam is heated, toxic chemicals can transfer from the plastic into the food and drink the containers were designed to protect. And finally, after the plastic foam has been used just once, it often ends up floating in waterways and oceans, where it breaks into tiny pieces that animals mistake for food, which can lead to their early death. At the time, over 4 million foam trays in New York City alone were being trashed every week to be taken to landfills, where plastic foam can last for up to 500 years, or burned in fiery incinerators, where it can produce harmful fumes. The disposable lunch trays didn't just disappear. They hung around, degrading into smaller and smaller pieces, and potentially leaching toxic chemicals, polluting and poisoning our soil, water, marine life, our very cells. Gross, right? And this was a normal part of everyday life. Yet when the students thought about it, they didn't want gross to be the norm. So they got together, they spoke out, they contacted government officials, they became activists. And within a year, all New York City public schools, more than 1,600 at the time, had set up Trayless Tuesdays, replacing plastic foam trays with paper containers on, yeah, Tuesdays. In 2014, New York City public schools eliminated plastic foam trays entirely from their cafeterias and replaced them with compostable, sustainably produced, earth-friendly ones. Today, styrofoam out of schools is called cafeteria culture, and works with youth to achieve zero-waste schools, plastic-free waters, and climate-smart communities. At schools like the Brooklyn New School, young activists didn't just focus on trays. They grew food on the school playground. They instituted a salad bar and a school-wide recycling and composting program, and made sustainability a part of the school curriculum. They changed their behavior. They changed their culture. They transformed their way of life. Activists, a group of people working to create change for the better in the world. Activists generally believe in using direct public action, such as protests and marches, to show support for, or opposition to, a cause or organization. We can all be superheroes. In the beginning, the mission of those young activists might have seemed unnecessary, wacky, even impossible. A lot of people probably told the students they were wasting their time. But those kids knew that it wasn't just about school lunch. They had done the research and learned that our garbage and how we dispose of it says a lot about who we are. And it was pretty clear to them that they did not want to be polluting, poisoning, life-stealing citizens whose behavior was threatening the future of the Earth more than any superhero movie villain ever could. You probably don't want to be that either. Even though cartoon villains do get to do some cool-seeming stunts for a while, things never turn out well for those bad guys in the end, and they leave a lot of destruction and pain in their path along the way. But it turns out that many of us have kind of been those bad guys for a while, and if we continue to live in ways that damage our air, our waters, our earth, that threaten our everything, our story won't end well either. It's time to write a new one. Young climate activists, in their own words. They keep talking about climate change being a matter of the future, but they forget that for people of the global south, it is a matter of now. Vanessa Nakate, Uganda, founder of Youth for Future Africa and Rise Up Movement. It is when indigenous peoples come together that powerful things happen. Through building relationships and sharing ideas, we can start to gather under the rafters of our own whare, a Maori building, to bring to light our own dreams, rather than just coming together when our governments or the UN wants us to. India Logan Riley. Nati kahungunu ki nati hawea ki wea teopiti. Aotearoa, New Zealand, a Maori activist for indigenous rights who participated in United Nations climate talks. My government has failed to take steps to regulate and reduce greenhouse gas emissions, which are causing extreme climate conditions. This will impact both me and future generations. My country has huge potential to reduce the use of fossil fuels. And because of the government's inaction, I approached the National Green Tribunal. Ritma Pandey, India, who at age 9 brought a court case against the Indian government for failing to keep its Paris Agreement promises. For young Indigenous women, access to information and participation in public policy remain a challenge. It is time that the world hears our voice, and the country recognizes Indigenous women as equal rights holders. Rayanne Christine Maximo França, Brazil, Indigenous Youth Network. I started my activism quite young, at 11. That was when I first heard about this thing called climate change. As a young girl in Samoa, a small island in the South Pacific, hearing the implications it had for my island scared me and jump-started my passion to do something about it. And feeling that you have a team, that you're not alone, that we're all in this together. It's not just one person yelling from outside the UN building or our parliament, and where there are mass numbers, there's power. Our slogan is, we're not drowning, we're fighting. Brianna Fruin, Samoa, founding member 350.Samoa, Future Rush, first youth ambassador of the Secretariat of the Pacific Regional Environment Program. One lesson much too well learned must be that something has to be done, not through the complicated negotiations and conference rooms of the United Nations, but through our own small actions. We can find solutions right here. In the long run, this may well be the vehicle through which solid decisions are taken on climate change issues. Winnie Asiti, Kenya, co-founder of African Youth Initiative on Climate Change. You've probably heard the somber predictions, the dire promises, the downright terrifying tales about global warming.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.